From the Cronkite studios in downtown Phoenix, this is Cronkite News.
Border agents are preparing to move migrants into a new shelter in Yuma. We tell you more about why some say this facility could be more costly than others. And it's been 6 years since the Yarnell Hill fire took the lives of 19 hotshots. We'll share what community members are doing this weekend to honor them. Also, playing political hardball, but not on Capitol Hill. Republicans and Democrats faced off on the field for charity.
Cronkite News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to Cronkite News on Arizona PBS. I'm Kevin Thompson.
And I'm Gabriella Collage. Thank you for joining us. A new detention facility opened today in Yuma. Border Patrol officials say they need the extra space to house migrants as they are processing after seeking asylum in the U.S.
Cronkite News reporter Amanda Slee has more.
The U.S. Border Patrol says they will start placing families in this new temporary facility by tonight.
This tent-like structure can hold up to 500 people and is air-conditioned. But a managing attorney at SEMA Law Group in Phoenix says a solution like this costs more money than other alternatives.
You can place an ankle monitor on the adult, on the mom or the father, and you can track them at all times, and the cost would only be a fraction than keeping them in a shelter.
For the last 2 years, the number of people coming from Central America has continued to increase. Border Patrol's 400-person capacity building in Yuma is often overcrowded.
Even before this detention spike took place, if you will, we did see that the majority of the people that would come in and seek asylum would show up to their court hearings.
The facility is equipped with TVs, washrooms, laundry machines, and some basic bathroom supplies.
Although this is a temporary detention center, there is no confirmed closure date. In the newsroom, Amanda Slee, Cronkite News.
More presidential hopefuls battling it out on the primary debate stage in Miami last night. 10 Democratic candidates shared with the American people what they would do if elected to the nation's highest office. Over the course of 2 hours, they addressed a range of topics, including health care, immigration, climate change, the economy, and President Trump's policies. There were tense moments and even some attacks. 20 of the 24 Democratic candidates will go head-to-head in two more debates next month in Detroit.
ICE officials in Phoenix have confirmed an outbreak of mumps amongst migrants in several Pinal County detention facilities. Officials say at last count, they have had 56 confirmed cases of mumps, along with an additional 81 suspected in Pinal County ICE detention facilities. Pinal County spokesman Joe Pirates says out of all the cases of mumps reported so far, one of them is an employee, while the rest are all detained migrants.
We've got to make sure it doesn't get out. And right now, our steps that we're taking, along with the facilities that do have the ICE detainees, have been very cooperative in helping us keep this localized.
In an emailed statement to Cronkite News, ICE responded in part by saying, quote, "We instituted numerous measures to prevent the spread of communicable diseases, including an initial medical screening upon arrival and a full medical checkup within 14 days. Our medical team's quick reaction to the presence of illness has resulted in a very low transmission rate." Nevertheless, dozens of other detained migrants have had to be placed under quarantine.
Anybody who may be suspected of having the mumps are put into a pod with other inmates who are suspected of having that.
ICE officials say detainees diagnosed with mumps are typically at the facility less than a month, approximately the time it takes for the virus to incubate and symptoms to appear. According to Pirates, those who don't have the virus are released from quarantine after 25 days, which is the standard incubation period for mumps. But for those who do have the disease,
they are given the MMR vaccination.
And during the quarantine period, detainees still have access to resources.
They are still allowed to meet with their lawyers. They're still allowed to meet with family.
Health officials say despite the outbreak inside the detention facilities, there's no current threat to the community, and the most they can do at this time is make sure those migrants coming in are getting vaccinated.
Today marks the 6th anniversary of the start of the Yarnell Hill fire. Many people are remembering the lives of the 19 Granite Mountain hotshots who died while battling the fire in 2013. On Sunday, a ceremony is happening at the Yarnell Hill Fire Memorial Park. Speakers will honor the hotshots and also talk about how the community has recovered since the tragedy. The Yarnell Hill Fire is the deadliest wildland blaze in the U.S. since 1933. At exactly 4:42 p.m. on Sunday, the bell at the Yavapai County Courthouse will ring 19 times as a tribute to those fallen hotshots.
More on the Woodbury fire. It's now 68% contained and almost 124,000 acres in size. Crews are trying new ways to fight the fire with technology like drones, which helps them see into areas that are too dangerous for firefighters. Investigators are still not sure what started the fire, but they do know it is human caused. And it's going to be a sizzling hot weekend, guys.
Pretty much everywhere, it's going to be hot. Ryan Sundin is tracking the forecast for us. Ryan.
So it's a typical day here in Arizona, guys. Phoenix is 99, Casa Grande is 99, Lake Havasu is 99, all the same. But up top north, we have Grand Canyon at 83, which is a nicer weather if you want to get out and go. Today, for the rest of the night, we have 108 where it jumps up and then it cools down from 6 o'clock on. So it'll be a little bit nicer at 10, but then again, it's a little late in the night to go out. For tomorrow, it's gonna jump up a lot higher. So we got 111 in Phoenix and then kind of 110 surrounding us. So it's gonna be a really warm day and a really sunny day. So remember to keep your sunglasses on and even keep sunglasses on your child because the UV radiation can come and get them. But for tomorrow during the day in the valley, we have 91 in the beginning of the day at 8 o'clock, and then we jump up to 108 and 110 by 4 o'clock. So if you want to get out there on a Saturday, I always say go earlier as opposed to later. For the state temperatures, for the week temperatures, we hit 111 again on Saturday, 110 on Sunday and Monday, but then we cool off as we go into 4th of July and then 4th of July weekend where it hits 106 and then 107 on Friday. Live from the Weather Sunday, it's Ryan Sundin.
And after 10 years, the city of El Mirage is going to stop using cameras to catch speeding drivers. The decision to end the speed photo enforcement program comes almost a year after an illegal speed trap was found. The city council returned more than $93,000 to drivers who were caught in the trap and had to pay fines. The cameras are going to be removed next month.
Well, members of Congress were playing political hardball in Washington this week, and some of it was even inside the Capitol. The actual hardball took place just about 2 miles away at Nationals Park, where Democrats and Republicans suited up for an annual charity baseball game, a rite of summer in D.C., as Julian Pardas reports from our Washington Bureau.
Baseball is said to be America's favorite pastime. It's a time to be with friends and a time to have fun. And for Congress, both sides, Democrat or Republican, the annual congressional baseball game is both.
It's America's pastime, the game of summer, a game of inches, and most of all, baseball is a game of tradition.
Tradition is important, and this is a great tradition. One of the great traditions of the United States Congress is this friendly rivalry between the Republicans and Democrats.
One of those traditions is trash talking, and it's no different at the annual congressional baseball game.
Well, it isn't that we're beating the Democrats, we're just beating the team that's not as good as us.
Stanton, playing in his first game as a congressman, talked smack right back at Biggs.
Is Biggs playing over there?
Yeah.
Oh, wow, okay. Yeah, so I definitely want to outplay my friend Andy Biggs, for sure, yeah.
The game was first played in 1909 and has been played most years since. Despite the partisan nature of the teams, lawmakers say it lets them move beyond party politics of Washington and raise money for charity at the same time.
It's a lot of fun. You could do something that's good for the community. And again, you get to spend some time outside of the realm of politics to get to know other people, not just based on what they're voting and how they're voting.
Charities include local Boys and Girls Clubs, literacy groups, and a fund for U.S. Capitol Police after two were wounded in a shooting 2 years ago during a GOP practice for the game.
You want to be part of a worthy cause, and if we were just out here playing ball, that wouldn't be good enough. But the fact that we're able to help raise money that's going to go to help some people, that really makes it special.
The first game took place in 1909, and for over 100 years, congressional members have participated in this bipartisan event for charity. At Nationals Park, Julian Pardas, Cronkite News.
And despite Congressman Biggs' confidence, Democrats won Wednesday night's game by a score of 14-7, tying the long-running series at 42-42-1.
Today marks the 50th anniversary of the Stonewall Riots, a seminal moment in the history of the LGBTQ rights movement. As Cronkite News reporter Kyla Wilcher explains, when the Mercury held their Pride Night event earlier this month, the significance of that anniversary was front and center for Mercury Center Brittany Griner.
This is like a big one, really monumental, and just happy to be a part of it.
The Stonewall Riots, which began after police raided a gay bar in June 1969, drove the creation of the modern LGBTQ rights movement. The Mercury honored that legacy through outreach to the LGBTQ audience.
This is awesome, you know. Yeah. We've done a lot, sure. And in the community, but you know, we got a lot more to do.
In 2014, the WNBA became the first professional sports league to specifically target the LGBTQ community.
Our game isn't just about basketball. Our game is, you know, our league exists at the intersection of women and people of color and the LGBT community and its allies. And that sort of intersectionality gets people to try it out because, like I said, it's a welcoming place.
The attendance at Pride Night has steadily grown from 9,100 in the event's first year in 2014 to 10,400 earlier this month.
The crowds are much bigger. I think with the diversity that we have in the city and the valley here that, you know, it just gets bigger and bigger every time.
Kozar says the Mercury are the only professional team in the valley with openly LGBTQ players. And celebrating that encourages inclusiveness for fans like Richard Smith.
It feels good to know that there's other people like me and athletes and professionals and, you know, famous celebrities or whatnot, you know, we're not alone.
According to the nonprofit Movement Advancement Project, nearly 250,000 adults in Arizona identify as LGBT. That's 4.5% of the state's population, up from 4% in 2015. In Phoenix, Kyla Wilcher, Cronkite News.
Coming up, an effort to stop a deadly problem.
The number of pedestrian deaths reaching record numbers. Victims' families and advocates are now fighting for change, what they're doing in their communities to make a difference.
And how one hockey player's special moment of getting selected to play for the Arizona Coyotes was made even better by sharing it with his father. That story and more next.
Welcome to another edition of Cronkite Sports Now. I'm Taylor Rocha. Let's talk sports.
For the latest on local sports and beyond, we've got you covered.
Let's do this thing.
We challenge reporters to go beyond, you know, a game story. We want stories with depth.
It's just a really crucial step from the college experience into the professional experience while you're still in school.
At Cronkite Sports Now, watch the journalists of tomorrow cover sports today.
As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night.
The song came from my mother's fear. You know, you're going out on the road and these girls are coming up and to you, and he wrote, "I walk the line. I'm gonna stay true to you."
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine.
Millions of people die every year from drinking dirty water. I would never have felt I had the ability to do something without ASU pushing me. We built filtration systems out of local materials with the people. To see those kids drink clean water for the first time, it's the most rewarding feeling that you can ever have. I went to ASU because I wanted to change the world. The thing I never would have expected is how the world would have changed me.
When we first started giving to PBS, you know, we were much younger and gave what we felt we could. And then as the years went by, you know, we just felt that it was part of what we wanted to do, that we didn't want to leave all of our money just to our family, that there were other places. And PBS is the kind of platform that enables so many people to enrich their lives.
For more information about including Arizona PBS in your future plans, visit azpbs.org/giving.
Pedestrian deaths are the highest they've been since 1990. According to federal statistics, nearly 50,000 people have died on U.S. roads since 2009. The reasons vary. Some blame cell phones and others distracted driving.
Others say sprawling cities and wide roads are the bigger culprits. A team of reporters from the Howard Center for Investigative Journalism here at ASU have been investigating what victims' families and advocates say are slowly changes to a deadly problem.
Above a busy intersection in Los Angeles, a sign cautions motorists to drive with care. It's yards away from where 17-year-old Christian Vega was struck and killed in February.
Get out, Nico. He was a good kid, a good child.
Respetuoso.
Very respectful.
To his family, Christian Vega was quiet and kind, a nurturing figure to his siblings. His mother describes his absence as an unfillable void. They take comfort visiting the site where he was killed. The intersection of Riverside Drive and Newell Street is a busy area, with a bus line connecting the neighborhood to food, medical care, and other vital needs. Although the area hasn't changed, the amount of traffic has. Navigation apps are guiding motorists away from heavy interstate congestion and on to Riverside Drive. The result? More cars and higher speeds.
Riverside Drive, it's become a fifth lane of the 5 freeway.
David De La Torre and other concerned residents have called for safety improvements along the street for years. City engineers approved a left turn signal at the intersection in 2017. But it wasn't installed until after Christian's death because the city says funding was unavailable.
We have a reactionary government when it should have been more proactive to prevent such an incident from happening.
But Christian's incident isn't unique.
We've seen a nearly 50% increase in the number of pedestrians fatally struck by vehicles on American intersections and roadways since 2009, a reversal of what had been a decades-long decline.
Streets are wider. Streets are so wide that streets are basically freeways sometimes, or they have freeway-like speeds.
Daisy Villafuerte with the advocacy group Los Angeles Walks says the city wasn't designed for walking, which leaves pedestrians vulnerable.
If you try to walk a street, you'll spend a good 10 minutes without ever seeing a crosswalk.
Unlike older, denser East Coast cities that were built before automobiles ruled the roads, Sunbelt cities like Phoenix and Los Angeles were built with cars as the dominant mode of transportation.
We're seeing an epidemic of pedestrian crashes happening on arterials.
Engineer Randy Ditburner says that pedestrians and vehicles use the same major roadways, which creates conflict.
But that's where the pedestrians want to be, just like that's where everybody wants to be. That's the way to get through our cities and towns.
A good example? Southern Avenue in Phoenix, where 15-year-old Keyshawn Hubanks was killed by a car in December. Hubanks was crossing the street when his family says a driver sped out of her lane and hit him. His mother, Nida Richards, found him on the curb.
Once I, took his hood off his head, I just knew he was gone.
Although only a freshman in high school, Keyshawn was independent. He took the bus to school and helped care for his siblings.
I didn't have to worry about the kids while I was at work or, he knew what to do, knew when to do it and how to do it.
The Hubanks apartment complex is half a mile away from signaled crosswalks on Central and 7th Avenues. That's a long way to walk for people who need to catch a bus to school or work.
That makes no sense. Kids are going to be kids. I can't sit up and tell you I walked to Central just to go to the dollar store.
National advocacy groups say crashes like Keyshawn's are more common in low-income areas. It's evident in Southern California, where residents in underserved neighborhoods are waiting for safer streets.
Early infrastructure that a lot of other parts of the city take for granted just never got to this part of the area.
Los Angeles District 6 Councilmember Nuri Martinez knows this neighborhood lacks some crucial road safety elements like sidewalk accessibility ramps.
For a mom who's trying to get to work every morning and drop off her kid with a stroller, how is that mom supposed to be able to cut across the street and use that sidewalk or that side of the sidewalk when there is not an accessible way for her to do so?
These ramps are now being built as a part of Vision Zero, a program Los Angeles adopted with the goal of having zero traffic fatalities by the year 2025.
But that's the infrastructure needs that I think that we've been waiting for a really long time. We're finally starting to get to make sure that these communities of color in particular, that those needs are starting to get addressed.
City officials like Chief Engineer Dan Mitchell say the Vision Zero program can't succeed without buy-in from the community.
That effort really takes everyone's involvement. It's not something that the city of Los Angeles can impose on everyone else. It's something that takes everyone's commitment.
Families who have lost loved ones are often the people pushing for change.
I think we need to get more people like me, a family who's been affected or a survivor, to actually go to one of their meetings and talk to the residents themselves.
Debbie Shung and Philip Tam started the organization Southern California Families for Safe Streets after their oldest son, 7-year-old Aiden Tam, was killed while crossing the street.
And all of a sudden, I saw a driver make a right turn into the crosswalk. Aiden got hit. We ran over. The truck was on top of Aiden.
The couple wants safer roads and safer drivers. They know changing laws and minds is a challenge. But it's not impossible. The European Union has seen a 35% decline in pedestrian deaths between 2008 and 2017. Experts say it's because, unlike the U.S., Europe forced car makers to redesign vehicles to lower the chances of death.
It should not necessitate a death. It should not necessitate a lawsuit for action to occur.
At the end of the day, community leaders and advocates like De La Torre say they want government agencies to take a more proactive approach to roadway design and pedestrian safety. And while they keep working to make streets safer for pedestrians, the families of Keyshawn, Aiden, and Christian keep working through their grief.
While the death count has risen in the U.S., European Union countries have seen a 35% decline between 2008 and 2017. Experts say it's due in part to stricter car design regulations.
There's now an easy way to visit unique places in Hawaii without leaving your home.
Yeah, it turns out there's a new virtual field trip you can take. And as Cronkite News reporter Amanda Slee explains, it comes from a collaboration between an Arizona university and a private school in Hawaii.
Kamehameha Schools teamed up with Arizona State University to create this virtual field trip where you can explore what are called special places in Hawaii. This immersive experience was created by integrating STEM and place-based education.
This virtual experience was launched to help students in classrooms around the world learn about history, culture, and the environment of two sacred places in Hawaii. It's considered place-based education.
Place-based education is very similar in many ways to what they call aina-based education. In Native Hawaiian culture, they also have this very strong sense of place and teaching through place.
The virtual field trip, also known as VFT, includes interactive 360-degree video, photographs, and interviews. It took just under 3 years to complete this VFT between ASU and Kamehameha Schools, a private educational charitable trust for K-12.
It's not only intended to inform, but also to inspire people to look inward into their own place.
He says this online field trip helps make your real visit to the area more valuable and meaningful, so you have an idea of what to expect.
It's kind of like going to Disneyland, right? You're taking a child to Disneyland who's never heard of Disneyland before, and you just show up. They're going to have a great time. They're going to enjoy themselves. But if you start sharing with them about Disneyland, they start doing a little bit of searches on the web, talking to their friends about Disneyland, it builds up anticipation and their expectations on how to behave, what's going to be there, what they can look forward to.
They have created two tours, one of a suburban spiritual significance and the other of a more remote area that would take a 1 mile hike over lava rocks and soft sand.
It's kind of cool to see that people are trying to preserve these, like, the mo'olelos of Hawaii. And when you think about it, like, not a lot of people know them, so this is a good way for people to get to learn about it.
And virtual field trips like this will continue being a way to help students learn about the world around them.
Technology advances, and we find ways to assimilate an education, and I see no reason to think that in 10 years, 20 years, students won't routinely be doing all sorts of virtual explorations.
The virtual experience is meant to help students at Kamehameha Schools learn, but is open and available to anyone who wants to take the virtual tour. In the newsroom, Amanda Slee, Cronkite News.
Arizona Coyotes prospects skate this week at the team's prospect development camp at Gila River Arena.
It's been 7 years since the Arizona Coyotes last made the Stanley Cup playoffs. But as Ethan Schmidt reports, the franchise hopes an 18-year-old from Sweden can help end the drought.
Arizona Coyotes are proud to select from Brynäs in the Swedish Hockey League, Victor Soderstrom.
Arizona Coyotes first-round draft pick Victor Soderstrom is stepping onto the ice as an official prospect this week, just days after the team traded up from 14 to the 11th pick to draft him.
We tried to move up 7, 8, 9. Like, we tried to move up as high as we could and offered a lot to get up there and made sure we left no stone unturned to get our guy.
It's really a dream come true for my whole family and, you know, getting to a city like Phoenix, it's awesome.
Yeah, I don't understand it. It's amazing. So the dreams come true. Oh.
The Coyotes had plenty of options with their first round pick in this year's draft, but Chyka said the organization would do whatever it took to secure Soderstrom. Now, the future is looking a bit brighter on the blue line for Arizona, and the 18-year-old Swede could play in the NHL as soon as next season.
He's physically mature, he's mentally mature, he's got the skill set, so, you know, it'll be whatever's best for his development long-term and where he's at coming into camp.
I think I'm a two-way deal with offensive upside. I think I'm a, you know, I have good hockey sense, hockey IQ. I'm a smooth skater, skilled.
If he can make the NHL roster, Soderstrom will fit right in with fellow Swedish defenseman Oliver Ekman-Larsson, Coyotes captain, and Nick Hjalmarsson. In Glendale, Ethan Schmidt, Cronkite News.
On the next Arizona Horizon, it's the Journalists Roundtable. Martha McSally gets a rousing endorsement from President Trump. What does it mean for McSally's campaign? The endorsement comes as a political newcomer makes noise about challenging McSally in the GOP primary.
I'm Judy Woodruff on the next NewsHour on display. Jeffrey Brown is our guide to a showcase of the best of modern American art. That's Friday on the PBS NewsHour.
That's it for Cronkite News tonight. Thanks for joining us.
For top Arizona stories anytime, go to CronkiteNews.azpbs.org.